All right, welcome to Exotic Astrology, ladies and gentlemen. Today I am again delighted to have Anuradha ji on this channel. So today she will be enlightening us with Pushya Nakshatra, and if you have any planets or even if you don't, then please stay tuned and watch the videos. It will be an amazing session. I was seeing the slides, so I was amazed. So please share about Pushya Nakshatra today. Welcome.
Thank you so much, Bhavajit. One of the very beautiful nakshatras, Pushya is that nakshatra that allows and prospers everything that comes in its way except for marriage. There's always a spot even on the moon. So marriage is that black spot on the Pushya nakshatra. It is said that Sri Ramchandra ji got married in this nakshatra, and so he had to suffer that agony of separation from his wife. Even B.V. Raman in his book on Muhurta writes that Pushya is that one nakshatra which allows every beautiful thing to flourish under it, but for marriage. And we'll see why and how and a lot of more interesting facts about Pushya in this coming slides. So let's move on to the slides.
Yeah, I'm able to see that. Perfect.
Okay. So the deity of Pushya Nakshatra is Brihaspati. And Pushya Nakshatra, it covers the stellar constellation in terms of zodiacal space. It covers 3 degree 20 minutes of Cancer to 16 degree 40 minutes of Cancer, and that is as per sidereal of Vedic astrology. As we move further, we see the stars. The stars covered by Pushya are Theta Cancery, Gamma Cancery, and Eta Cancery, because it lies in the zodiacal space that belongs to Cancer. Pushya had many names. What does Pushya actually mean? Pushya means to nourish. Okay, or to give sustenance to something or somebody. Pushya also means push or a flower, something which is beautiful, something which is delicate, something which is appealing, something which is very natural. And one of the ancient names of Pushya was Tishtya, which is a celestial archer, or it was also something which is a very nourishing kind of a value attached to it. And another name is Siddhya, which is Siddhya means divine knowledge, divine attributes in terms of knowledge. Pushyami is also one of its names. Okay, now what is the power? Like we've seen in the last few nakshatras, we've gone also seen the power of the nakshatra. So what is the power of this nakshatra? The power of this nakshatra is Brahma Vachaspa Shakti. So what do you mean by Brahma Vachaspa Shakti? It is the ability for a person. You all of us have a seed of spirituality within us. There is a seed of spirituality that is embedded within us below our, our connect, our nabhi. That is our navel, and it's just two fingers below our navel. It's said to be the seat of the soul. Now that power needs to be harnessed. The kundalini needs to rise up. The ability to allow the kundalini shakti or to that will come in ashlesha, but the ability to harness that spiritual power from that seat is associated with this nakshatra. So a lot of people will be pulled towards spirituality without this nakshatra. If other conditions are not conducive, then it's a different matter. But if conditions are conducive, you may be in any profession. You may be Gordon Ramsay. You may be in any profession. He is a chef. We've done that with Anuradha also for him, if I'm not mistaken. He's a chef, but then he has an element of spirituality in him because he helps the poor so much. So you can do a number of things with that. You can express that in a number of ways, your creative and spiritual energy. The foundation above is the sacrificial worship, and the foundation below is the worshipper, the person who is, you know, it's, that's an expression, that's an extension. And the desire of this nakshatra, the desire of the deity of this nakshatra, was to possess the splendor of spiritual knowledge. Brihaspati, who is the deity of this nakshatra, wanted to have that spiritual knowledge to move himself onto a different level. The desire of the Shakti, the basis and the result of the Shakti, basis and desire, together they give us the creation of spiritual energy. So that spiritual energy that Pushya so radiates is because of the desire, the Shakti and all combined together.
Fantastic.
You have a very strong Jupiter sitting here. You do have the ability to harness that power.
And Jupiter also gets exalted here in 5 degrees, peak exaltation.
Yes. Yes. So the knowledge is at its best in this nakshatra, as you will see with Gordon Ramsay also, you will see that it is at its best. And nourishing, nurturing and caregiving. Now Mother Teresa. Mother Teresa has her Venus. Venus, as we know, Venus is also the karaka of resurrection or from death. It is also here in her chart, it's the sixth lord of death, disease, hospitality, care, selfless service, and the 11th lord of achievements, the 11th lord of contacts, the 11th lord of again because of bhavad bhavam. Okay, the 11th, 6th to 6th would be 11th house. So it would reflect on all the qualities of its own house in the qualities of the sixth house. Okay, for those who do not know the concept of bhavad bhavam, let me explain. Say, you take one house, I take the third house. So third house represents your courage, third house represents your siblings, third house represents your writing, everything. So when we count three more places from the third house, third, fourth, fifth. So that comes to the fifth house. That is bhava bhavam, third to third. So fifth house also shows courage. It also shows publication, that is writing, and it also shows initiation. So that is it. So 11th house is sixth to sixth. So it gives us the all the qualities in extra to its own house as the sixth house represents. Now, Mother Teresa was very well known. She's also called Saint Teresa because she was, you know, given sainthood after her death. And she was one of those people who gave a very beautiful death service to the poor. You know, the poor in Kolkata, I have seen it with my own eyes. Her cars and their ambulance would pick people up from the streets who were so poor, dying, and left on the roads to have a very pathetic death. They would pick them up and they would take to Nirmal Hriday, okay, and there they were given a burial, a pray or whatever they, according to the religion that they belong to, a proper death ceremony was held for them. So, and she had Nirmal Hriday also ran orphanages and lots of institute to help the poor. She always said that a helping hand is more important than a praying person, you know, because if you help somebody, you did the deed for the God. So she has her Venus, which is the sixth lord and the 11th lord in the eighth house of transformation and death. And in Pushya Nakshatra. So she helped transform a very heinous death for the poor to a very, very beautiful death service. And she nurtured thousands and thousands of orphans at her homes, orphanages, as small children, and brought them up very beautifully, not leaving them on the streets.
Fantastic.
So So let's move on to Brihaspati and the political advisors of preceptors and preceptor of gods. So Brihaspati or Guru, Brihaspati, who Guru or Jupiter, as he's known as in Vedic astrology, he is Brihaspati. And he is, we all know, the Saturn is Jupiter is the largest planet apart from Sun in the solar system. And so he has a very big stature in Vedic astrology, and he has the maximum number of points in the Ashtak Varga. So he is said to be a benefic, the most beautiful benefic. But this benefic, it is because others respect him so much to give him that point in Ashtak Varga.
Okay. Everybody wants him.
Yeah, and everybody is respecting him that much. Okay, and there's also a story, if we have time, we'll do that story also, that what happens when he is not around for the students. But for now, we need to know that he has been the teacher, he has been the guru, and he has been the guiding factor for Indra and his entourage of devatas. He's said to be the one who takes them into the right path, who guides them. Brihaspati as a teacher, okay? Brihaspati as a planet gives you 16 kinds of wealth. It is capable, Jupiter is capable of giving us 16 kinds of wealth. Let's start from house, okay? It rules the first house. It gives you good, a tall stature. If you have Jupiter sitting in your Lagna, you're tall, you have broad, you know, you have a good physique. In the second house, Jupiter gives you family, it gives you children, it gives you wealth. It gives you a good lineage. In the fourth house, it gets exalted, so it gives you the comforts of life and happiness, because fourth house is happiness. Fifth house, good grandparents, good children, mantra shakti. Seventh house, it is in a female's chart related to spouse. Ninth house, judiciousness, righteousness, dharmic activities, study of the scriptures. 10th house, name, fame and gain, right? 11th house, prosperity, name again, gains, money. And 12th house, charity. And I must have missed a few here and there. So that's the way Jupiter works. So obviously, because he gives so many things, and he is the Karaka of so many houses, so he is revered. And being the owner of this nakshatra, and I'll take it up later when we're doing Saturn and Brihaspati, when these two together combine, I've always said that when Jupiter and Saturn combine in whoever's chart, if Jupiter and Saturn are together, and I see it in Prince William's chart also, when they are together, that person has amazing capability as an administrator. Because we'll do it later. We'll do it later. Here I don't have Prince William's chart because it's not in the Pushya. I don't think he has anything in Pushya. But so we will do it. We'll do this combination when we're coming to Saturn, the lord of this nakshatra. He also comes from a very good lineage, and so he has, you know, he comes from the lineage of Angiras, one of the seven Saptarishis, and so he and his sons, are also well known. One of them has been taught by Bhrigu or Venus, you know, Shukracharya. One of them have been taught by Shukracharya the art of resurrection, and Kutch was his name. Okay, and he had gone, and there's a beautiful story again.
That Devyani story.
Yeah. So there was that Devyani story. Yes. So there is so much in it. We do not know where to stop, you know, and where to start. But I'll stick to the, you know, the PPT, and I just say that Bhrigu, you know, Shukracharya and Brihaspati were together taught by Shukracharya's father, and yet the gods opted for Brihaspati or Jupiter as their teacher, their preceptor over Venus or Shukracharya, and that enraged him. And then there's a consequence and a lot of things to be followed. That is why, that is the reason there is a strong sense of animosity between Shukracharya and Brihaspati. That is why these two planets together, wherever they sit, there's a lot of upheaval there, because they're not allowing the other person to finish their work, to do a lot of job.
Jupiter Venus conjunct, you mean?
Yes, Jupiter, it's good. It's good because it gives you a lot of name fame. But at the same time, internally, you will feel that there are a lot of issues that are simply in a turmoil all the time. So if they're sitting in somebody's second house, the person may get a lot of wealth, because Venus is also the significator of wealth and so is Jupiter. But the family life can have problems. Whichever house they're sitting in together, one portion of that, one karaka, one signification of that house will definitely undergo a lot of turmoil.
Okay.
In terms of prosperity, these two planets will definitely try to outdo each other, giving prosperity to the house. But okay, some emotional factors, some way or the other, there is a line missing. Okay. So we see that, okay, he is the high priest and he also rules over speech. Second house is speech. So if there is Jupiter sitting in somebody's second house, that person will speak with a lot of care and concern, and he will speak only what is desirable and what is valuable, because Jupiter is value based. So only that is valuable, that is required, that person will speak. So he is also the god of lord of sacred speeches and prayers. So whatever you want to learn, say supposing you were just saying that somebody wants to learn Ram Raksha Stotra, so you please pray to Jupiter, please help me to learn it up, or Mercury Buddha, because he's also one of those if you're planning to do mathematics, then if you ask Mercury for his assistance, quick response. He was given the lordship of the planet Jupiter by God, Lord Shiva. Lord Shiva was pleased with his knowledge, pleased with his work, pleased with his hardship, and he said, okay, fine, this is your jurisdiction. He's author of books on law. Yes, and one of the major thing that he is good at, that is politics. In spite of all that he's taught and everything that he is to the devatas, he may not be the king, but he's more powerful than the king, because he's the power behind the king.
If he's there, if he's not there, nothing moves.
Yes. So he's in the fourth house. It gets exalted in the fourth house of the natural zodiac. The fourth house of the natural zodiac represents the throne. So people having Jupiter placed in the Pushya Nakshatra, or in last Pada Cancer, that is in Cancer, they have the ability to be power makers, king makers. Okay, and he's the teacher of Jyotish and astronomy. He gives sustenance to those around him. Yes, and if he's big, if he's exalted, you will see people with an exalted Jupiter will give a lot of help, a lot of sustenance to those around them. They will try to enrich those people. They act as mother figures.
Yeah.
Or as guru, depending on their placement in the nakshatras, depending on that placement. Okay. Kamadhenu. So you were just now telling me that whenever Pushya Nakshatra comes into play, you always realize that there's something regarding milk that comes into your notice. So one of the symbols of Pushya Nakshatra, as we said that you know, Pushya is the star which nourishes, okay, or it is the nakshatra which nourishes. So milk, you know, is the major form of nourishment across all the all the vertebrae, or should I say the mammals on this planet. All the females in the mammal category, they raise their children with their own milk, right? So that is a sustaining power. And another story goes, I'll make it very short because there's one story I want to talk about in detail, that once earth was not giving anything to the people living on earth, nothing sustenance, because the people were being very unruly, very problematic and everything, so on and so forth. So what earth did was, she started hiding all her bounty from people. And then what happened was, the people got really afraid because earth was a source of sustenance, was the only source of sustenance. Anything that is grown on earth will come back to us as food. And you know, so what they did was, they worshipped Prithu, the king god, and they asked him to, on their behalf, to go to the gods and to pray for something to be done so that earth would reap benefits. So they he insists, Lord Brahma gave him the power to, you know, evoke the earth's bounty. And then he goes to earth and says that if you do not give any but us the sustenance, I'm going to get rid of you. So she takes a form of cow and she, you know, she tries to hide and run away, but finally she cannot run away from that king. And she says, okay, you people come to me in form of calves, the most important, and as per your requirement, I will let you people have my milk in that form so that you can prosper in that particular genre. So the king of the kings went, Swayambhu, he went in form of a calf, and he got the ability to save earth as a warrior. Then Jupiter was sent by the sages to worship, to get all the knowledge, the mantras, the shaktis, the all the Vedic knowledge for the entire rishis and the sages. So Kamadhenu is another, not Kamadhenu, cow is another association of this nakshatra, and Kamadhenu is the cow which is associated with this nakshatra because it is the wish fulfilling cow. Anything, it was got from the Samudra Manthan.
Oh.
One of the bounties of the Samudra Manthan was Kamadhenu, and she actually fulfills the heart's desire, not just the milk and the butter and the ghee, but anything that is asked to her with reverence, she fulfills it, and she was given to the rishis for safekeeping and to help them in their day-to-day work and prayers and everything.
Fantastic.
Okay, so we come to this very important story, one of the more focal stories of Pushya Nakshatra, where we will get a lot of keywords and key points, Brihaspati, Tara and Soma. So now Brihaspati, as we've seen, he is the Dev Guru. He is one of the kingmakers. He is the political advisor. He is one of the major key heads in the court and the council of Indra. And he has to do a lot of yagnas. He has to do a lot of pas to increase his own power. Penance also he has to do to increase his own power and to increase the power of Indra. In doing so, in being so very dedicated to his duties and his work, he misses or he neglects his wife Tara. She's a very beautiful wife. She's symbolic of all the stars of the zodiac. So the stars are very beautiful, right? She's supposed to be one of the most beautiful ladies. And but anything we have, we take it for granted. So she was also probably taken for granted by her husband, and she did not like the fact. She felt neglected. Now, Moon, the changeable person, okay? Moon has a very flirtatious nature, very changeable personality. So wherever Moon sits, you will find a flirtatious nature. Now, Moon is a personality which is, he is enamored by Tara. Okay, Chandra is very enamored by Tara, and he is also one of the students of Brihaspati. So technically, she is his guruma.
Yes.
But he is captivated by her, and slowly and steadily, knowing that she's a neglected wife, he's able to get her attention and finally seduces her. And they move out. So once they move out, and once Brihaspati realizes it, come to knows of it, he's very angry and he's extremely upset about the entire thing. So he stops all his prayers and everything with respect to the Devatas. Now the Devatas are very worried. So if they